Hi, I'm Daphne Richards, and this is Augie. Our question this week is on soil pH. Can we really do anything about it? Do coffee grounds, eggshells, pine straw, or cedar mulch make any difference? And how does rainfall affect things? This is a great question because the answer is both yes, we can, and no, we can't. And with so much information out there, it's easy to seize on just a small part of the answer, usually the part that reaffirms what we hoped for, and just stop reading. Also, it's hard to understand the difference geography makes on this issue. Pine straw has very little effect for us in Central Texas since we don't get tons of rain. Here, pine straw dries up before it can decay in a way that would yield any acidifying effects to our soil. So then, you'd need to keep the pine straw relatively wet in order to counter this issue and acidify your soil a bit. But then again, water conservation is very important for us. So is it really a good idea to use more of it to combat nature? Coffee grounds also have a slightly acidifying effect, but still it's short-lived. For lowering soil pH, using sulfur is the recommendation, and it does work, but only short-term, meaning its effects aren't long-lasting. So it has to be applied often, far too often to be a part of any sustainable approach. Sulfur is really only recommended in vegetable gardens, and even then, only if plants are struggling and high soil pH is part of the issue. Sulfur should be incorporated into the soil, not applied to the surface. And in vegetable beds, crops are changed out at least twice a year, which makes multiple applications of sulfur per year feasible. Also, the small square footage of vegetable beds makes the extra inputs into the system less of an issue. Even still, if you choose recommended cultivars for your area, soil pH will be less of an issue. But let's say you have a hydrangea that was given to you by your grandmother, and it's in a small bed that you can tend and provide extra care for. By all means, add those coffee grounds or pine straw and give that area a little extra water. Our plant of the week is Satsuma orange. Viewer Bev Boyce, who moved to Texas 3 years ago, shares her tips. Her tree is growing in a half whiskey barrel and kept in a greenhouse. She has other citrus trees as well and uses an organic citrus fertilizer. That's great because citrus are heavy feeders, needing regular fertilizer to stay healthy, bloom, and produce fruit. Fertilize about once a month through spring and summer, but give them a rest from fall through late winter. Bev gives her trees plenty of space, which increases the amount of sunlight to each leaf, and she uses only high-quality potting mix. She also stresses the importance of not planting too deeply, being sure that the graft union is well above the soil line. In addition to Satsuma, Bev says that Meyer's lemons are some of the easiest citrus to grow. And for even more fun, consider starting a Meyer lemon from seed. Water well and don't prune too much, and be sure to bring indoors or into a greenhouse for the winter if there's any danger of temps in the 30s or even low 40s. Here's a first from Eileen McDilda in Elgin. Bees coming to visit cracked corn she uses for her chickens and ducks. We asked Tanya Phillips from Bee Friendly Austin about this. She said that yes, it's true that honeybees will visit the feed bins. The powder that comes off the bags of seeds and grains is like pollen, and if there's nothing in bloom, they'll go in search of around for other things to resemble pollen. As the weather begins to warm and the days grow longer again, the queen will need to gear up her egg laying, but the baby worker larva will need pollen. So if the colony didn't overwinter with extra pollen, the workers may be out hunting for substitutes until the flowers come into bloom. Eileen's now providing sugar water for the bees too. Equal parts sugar and water. We'd love to hear from you. Check out klru.org/ctg to send us your questions, pictures, and videos.